In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's Word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Before we study God's Word today, I want to pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. If you just bow your head, please. We're going to pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege that we have now. As in our worship service, we are at that time and place where we are going to open your holy book and attempt to understand it. Lord, we know that we cannot understand your word unless your spirit opens the eyes of our mind, our understanding, so that we can understand spiritual things. Because you've told us in your word that spiritual things, the things of God, are foolishness to the natural man, and he cannot understand them. So we come to you humbly, praying earnestly that your spirit will be our teacher and that we might understand what you're trying to teach us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you been in a situation where the reality was not at all according to the appearance? Have you been in a situation like that? Probably, if you're more than 25 years old, probably you've been in a number of situations like that. When my wife and my son and I were living in Southern California, we lived about 65 miles east of Los Angeles, near a fairly large city called Riverside, California. And during this period of time, we moved there because I took a leave of absence. I was a pastor in North Dakota, but I took a leave of absence there because I wanted to study about medical missionary work at the School of Health at Loma Linda University. And during this time, part of my educational training, we had to serve a clerkship, and for the better part of a year, almost every day, I was either doing counseling, patient counseling myself, or I was seeing patients with a physician. And this one day, this was in another town, probably about 40 miles east of downtown Los Angeles. I was with a family practice physician in this clinic. I saw patients with a lady physician and two or three male physicians in this clinic. And I was with one of these gentlemen physicians this day. We were seeing patients, and he said to me, he said, we're going to have a visit that is not going to be pleasant. So he informed me about what was going to happen. He said, "We're going to have a consultation with this lady, and I'm going to have to tell her she has an incurable disease. It's terminal, and there's absolutely nothing that we can do about it. And I'm going to have to tell her this. This is not going to be a pleasant visit." So I was informed. What had happened is that she had had a number of medical tests done, and as a result of these medical tests, she had a certain abnormality. I can tell you what the abnormality was. That's not necessary. So we walked into the office where she was waiting to see us. And he sat down on one side of the desk, and she was on the other side of the desk, and I was over here. And I looked into this lady's face, and I thought, oh, no. When you looked at her face, you would never have any idea that she was sick. She didn't look sick. You couldn't tell that she was the least bit uncomfortable. She looked like a perfectly normal, healthy woman of approximately 40 years of age. But what you looked at, the appearance, was not the reality. She looked perfectly healthy and normal and attractive, but we knew something that we had to tell her. Things are not the way they seem. And that indeed was not a pleasant visit. I thought about that many times. I thought, you know, there have been, and I'm sorry to tell you this, and I'm not trying to depreciate the medical profession when I say this, but there have been physicians who have, in situations like that, that have decided not to tell the person the truth so they wouldn't feel bad. Would you like to go to a physician like that that didn't tell you the truth because they didn't want you to feel bad? If I go to a physician or a lawyer or a government official, the number one thing on my mind is I want them to tell me the truth. How about you? And sometimes it's not pleasant to find out the truth. It was not pleasant for that woman to find out the truth. But I'm glad that that physician believed that it was necessary for him, that he had a moral obligation to her to tell her the truth. I'm glad that he had that, felt that moral obligation and knew that that was the right thing for him to do. You know, the Bible says in Hebrews 6, it says that it is impossible for God to lie. It's impossible for God to lie. God will never, ever tell you something that's not true. Anything that God tells you will be the truth. But my dear friends, I say this respectfully of God, but God has gotten in a lot of trouble in the universe and in this world for telling the truth. Open your Bible. If you have your Bible, I'd like you to open it to John, the 8th chapter, and verse 45. John, the 8th chapter, and verse 45. This is Jesus speaking. Jesus is a divine person, so he never tells a lie. It is impossible for God to lie, the Bible says. Anything that Jesus tells you will be the truth. Now, notice what troubled Jesus got in, though, for telling the truth. John 8:45. This is Jesus speaking. Because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Why was it they didn't believe? Because he told them the truth. Well, why didn't they believe the truth? I want you to think that through. He was telling them the truth. They didn't believe it. Why did they not believe it? Since it was the truth, why did they not believe it? Well, they didn't want to hear it. That's true. Why did they not want to hear it? Let's think this through. Had these people been believing lies before Jesus came? Yes, they had. Are you ready for this one? The lie sounded better to them than the truth. The lie sounded better to them than the truth. By the way, when we were talking to that woman in that physician's office, would it have been possible for that physician to tell her a lie that she would have enjoyed hearing a lot more than the truth? Would that have been possible? Yes, it would. He could have told her a lie. And she'd have felt a lot better than she felt when she heard the truth. But I'm glad that he decided he had a moral obligation to tell her the truth. Jesus will never tell you a lie. But the problem that Jesus has is that when he tells the truth, because we have believed things that aren't true, when he tells us the truth, we don't want to believe that. I have told people sometimes, I said, how much truth can you stand? Now that may sound like a joke. That's not a joke. It's very serious. There are many people that can only stand so much truth. This person can stand that much. This person can stand that much. This person can stand. They can't stand all of it because it would just be too much. But if you want Jesus to speak to you, do you want Jesus to speak to you? Whatever he tells you is going to be the truth, and sometimes the truth won't be pleasant. So I want to study with you for a few minutes, just very introductory study. This is a chapter in the Bible that we read in our scripture reading, and it is absolutely loaded. It is a chapter that you could spend many hours studying through to understand all the phrases and all the clauses. So we'll just give an introductory study to it. But it's in Isaiah 58. And before I read the first four verses in Isaiah 58, I want to read a couple of statements that Ellen White wrote, one of them in 1897, about this chapter. Here's one statement. My brethren, you need to study more carefully the 58th chapter of Isaiah. This chapter marks out the only course that we can follow with safety. And here's another one. The whole chapter, that's Isaiah 58, the whole chapter is applicable to those who are living in this period of Earth's history. Consider this chapter attentively, for it will be fulfilled. So this chapter contains prophecies that will be fulfilled. Now, we're going to start at the beginning, and I've already warned you, sometimes the truth is not pleasant. So let's read. Cry aloud, spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Tell my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways. As the nation that did righteousness, and did not forsake the ordinance of their God, they ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching God. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen? Why have we afflicted our souls, and you take no notice? In fact, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure and exploit all your laborers. Indeed, you fast for strife and debate, and to strike with the fist of wickedness. You shall not fast as you do this day to make your voice heard on high. What's the problem here? This chapter begins to address people. They're God's people. They're called the house of Jacob. They're God's professed people. And they look like they are righteous. Remember the lady that we met in the office that day? How did she look? She looked like a perfectly healthy, normal woman of about 40 years of age. She looked perfectly healthy and normal and attractive. But sometimes things are not the way they appear. These people are not atheists or infidels or unbelievers or skeptics. These are religious people. These are people, they're very fastidious about their. These are people that they not only are religious, but they are strict in their religious practices. They fast. Remember the story of the man, the Pharisee, that Jesus told? And the Pharisee came and prayed, and he said, "Lord, I thank you that I'm not like other men. Extortioners and adulterers, or even like this tax collector over here." He said, "I pay tithes of everything I own, and I fast twice a week." By the way, have you ever tried to fast twice a week? Probably some people in here have never even tried fasting twice in a week. I have. Found out that I couldn't do that on a regular basis. I don't know how this fellow did. Some people can do it, some people can't do it. I couldn't do it. I just didn't have enough energy to keep going fasting twice a week. But these are very religious people. They fast. They are careful to observe religious ceremonies and ordinances. But what's the problem? Things are not the way they appear. They make a high profession of piety, and they have outward exactness in their religious practice in their life. But inside, there is wickedness. Things are not the way they appear. And they are complaining to the Lord. They're saying, "How come we do all these things? We fast, we afflict our souls, we're religious, we go to church, we participate in all the ordinances of the Lord, and you don't be even paying any attention. You just say that we're wicked, that we're sinners and we're transgressors." Now, these people profess to be linked up with God in obedience and fellowship, but they're actually far from Him. Jesus talked about these people in Matthew 15. Matthew 15, verses 8 and 9. This is Jesus speaking. He's quoting from the prophet Isaiah. He says, "These people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men." So, the appearance is that these people are righteous and holy people, but inside, they look all right on the outside, but inside, there is wickedness. And God won't tell you a lie. Like I said, I am very glad that position that I was with that day, that he believed that he had a moral obligation to tell the truth. God will not tell you a lie. God is going to tell you the truth. And God says, on the outside, you're religious and righteous and holy, but inside, you remember the story when Samuel was reviewing the sons of Jesse as to who was going to be the next king of Israel, and the oldest son passed before him. And this son was so tall and so handsome and so good-looking that Samuel said in his heart, "This is the one." And the Lord said, "No, that's not the one." And then the next one, Samuel said, "Well, then this is the one." The Lord said, "No, that is not the one." And finally, the Lord told him, he says, man looks on the outward appearance, but God doesn't look on the outward appearance. God looks on what's inside. My dear friend, the Bible says that God doesn't change. Malachi 3, God doesn't change. God's still the way He was then. When God looks at... Now, please don't misunderstand. As Christians, we should be neat, clean, appropriate in the way we dress and in our appearance. But that's not what God is most concerned about. When God looks at you, friend, when God looks at me, He looks at what's in the heart. Now, your heart has to do with your emotions and your feelings, who you love, what you love, and what you hate. All those things. God looks at your heart. And from a human point of view, there are many people, just like these people, and they go through all the right motions, just like the Pharisee. Here's all what I do. I pay tithe. I go to church. I participate in all the services of the church. I participate in all the ordinances. I fast. I practice health reform. I do all these things. Now, all those things are good. They're doing good things. But God says, what's in your heart? What's in your heart? Have you ever asked yourself the question? When God looks at your heart, and God knows what's in your heart, can you really say to the Lord, can you say, Lord, I love you with all my heart, soul, and mind, and I love my neighbor as myself. Can you say that? Very few people can say that. And yet Jesus said that's the sum and substance of what religion's all about. That's what it's about. Paul said, love is the fulfilling of the law. And so how are you going to help these people who they think we're doing all the right things? The Lord said, but inside it's not right at all. Lord, aren't you pleased that I'm so strict that I fast so that I... The Lord said, look, I'm going to tell you how to fast. I'm going to tell you how to fast. I'm going to tell you how to be religious. Would you like for the Lord to tell you how to practice religion? How to be religious? But He's going to tell you in this chapter. In fact, He is going to tell you 8 things that you can do so that you can become religious, really religious, not just have something on the outside. Let's read verses 5 to 7. Says, is this a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a bulrush and to spread out sackcloth and ashes? Would you call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord? I said verses 5 to 7, but maybe I need to stop right there for a moment. There are some Christians that if you watch them and were around them, you might almost get the idea that they were a band of mourners on their way to a funeral. If you are a Christian friend, you're not on your way to a funeral. You're on your way to everlasting life. And if you really believe that, when other people see you, well, let me tell you a story. Sometimes you learn better by stories. This is a true story. It actually happened to a man in the New Testament whose name was Paul. His original name was Saul, but he became his name Paul after he became a Christian. And Paul was finally given the death sentence by Nero, ruler of the Roman Empire. Paul was a Roman citizen, so that they could not torture him according to Roman law. They could not torture him, so... They did do that to Peter. Peter was not a Roman citizen, and he was crucified. You could not crucify a Roman citizen. Paul could not be crucified. But the emperor was so angry with him, he said, we're going to put him to death anyway. And so it was determined that he was going to be beheaded. And so they decided that they were going to take him out. It was in the summertime. They were going to take him out to the place of execution. And they decided, these Romans that were going to kill him, and they decided that they wanted as few people there as possible. Do you know why they wanted as few people there as possible? Because they had learned something from Peter and Paul and James and Stephen and a bunch of other Christians that they had killed. They had learned something. They had learned that when people just looked at their face, when they were on their way to be killed, people said, whatever they have, I want it. My friend, when you meet people in your work and whatever you do, when people look at your face, when they look at my face, do they say, whatever he has, whatever she has, I want it? Why did they feel that way? Because they saw those people were not on their way to a funeral, even though they were going to be killed in a few minutes. They saw they were on their way to eternal life, in a place where there wouldn't be any more suffering or death or sighing or sadness or trouble. And they were so happy about it that everybody that saw them, they looked at, in fact, Ellen White says that of the few people that were allowed to be present when the Apostle Paul was beheaded, that of those few people, some of them looked at his face and they said, I want to be a Christian. And there were Roman soldiers that decided, I'm going to be a Christian from now on. If when people look at your face or when they look at my face, if they're afraid that we're getting ready to go to a funeral, we don't have the right kind of religion. We don't really know the Lord yet. Well, I don't want to belabor that point, but that's something for you to pray about in your own devotions. If we have the genuine article, the Christian religion, people will see that we have something. Jesus is the most precious possession that any human being can have. I must not belabor that point, but think about it. Let's read verses 6 and 7. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness. That's number 1. To undo the heavy burdens. That's number 2. To let the oppressed go free. That's number 3. That you break every yoke. That's number 4. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry? That's number 5. And that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out? That's number 6. When you see the naked, that you cover him? That's number 7. And hide not yourself from your own flesh. You practice those things? One time, my brother Marshall was called to visit a certain family in their home. And the reason he was called to their home is, like so often when a preacher is called to somebody's home, the reason they're called is because there's somebody in trouble. So he came to this home. There was a man in this house. First of all, he had gotten so drunk that he couldn't function anymore. And so he fell on the floor. Now, drink, by the way, alcohol upsets your stomach. And it's not uncommon. If you've had to deal very much with people that do a lot of drinking, it's not very uncommon. A person drinks too much, they drink so much that your stomach eventually rebels and says, I'm not taking this anymore. So he had fallen on the floor, and then he had vomited, and the vomit was all over the floor, all around his head. And there he was. My brother came in the house. Here's this man, drunk, lying on the floor, vomit all around. What would you do? Well, got a washcloth, got some warm water and washcloth. First cleaned it up around, hid. And then he sat down on the floor, picked up this man's head, put this man's head in his lap, and he took the washcloth and he washed his face off. And then he just held his head and his hands there in his lap for a while. This man needed to find out about Jesus, and he needed to find out from somebody that wasn't going to condemn him, but just somebody that wanted to help him. And after all that happened, he was in a frame of mind to listen to whatever my brother had to tell him. Now, some of you might not believe this, but I'm going to tell you anyway. There have been many, many people who have been converted to Jesus Christ while they were drunk. Now, that may sound crazy to some of you. How in the world can they even think? The reason that is that they got in such a mess that they realized that they felt like they were at the bottom of a hole. And if you're at the bottom of the hole, you can't go any lower. You're down as low as you can get. And when you're as low as you can get, and you say, Lord, I need some help. There is somebody that wants to help you. And he not only wants to help you, he uses his servants to help people that are in these kind of conditions. Notice, it says, is it not to share your bread? That's verse 7. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry? What is described here in verses 6 and 7 is practical religion. Not just something that you say, well, I believe in this and this and this and this and this. There's millions of people that can tell you, well, I can recite the Apostles' Creed. Oh, I can recite the Ten Commandments. Oh, somebody says, I can recite the Beatitudes. Well, praise the Lord if you can recite those things. But is your religion practical in your everyday life so that people can see that you have something that the people of this world don't have? You could spend a lot of time studying these 8 points. I told you that all we can do here for a few minutes is look at a short introduction to this chapter. This is a powerful, powerful chapter. I invite you on your own to spend some time, go through verses 6 and 7 and say, Lord, help me to understand what this is about. What does it mean to break every yoke? I've thought for a long, long time, I would love to preach a sermon sometime. Maybe I will, if the Lord wills. I'd love to preach a sermon sometime on breaking every yoke. What's that mean? What does it mean when it says, let the oppressed go free? Are there oppressed people in your house that need to be set free? Something that we need to study. Well, I invite you. I invite you in your own devotional life, in your own study. Go through verses 6 and 7, start studying it. Try to understand what are these 8 points that the Lord's pointing out to us. He says, you want to be religious? Well, this is the way you become a religious person. This is the way you fast. It's not going through some religious ceremony. You're not just saying, well, I'm not going to eat today, therefore then I'm going to be more holy. No, it's practical. The Lord gives some wonderful promises in His Word, and in this chapter, the Lord says, now, if you do these 8 things, I'm going to do some things for you that, well, just read here what the Lord says He's going to do for the people that will do this. He says, starting in verse 8, then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily. Notice, it's going to affect your physical health. You're going to get better. Your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call and the Lord will answer. Notice, when you pray, God's going to answer your prayers. There is a reason, friend, why some people, when they pray, their prayers are answered, and when other people, when they pray, it seems like the Lord is just silent. There's a reason for that. The reason is in this chapter. Then you shall call and the Lord will answer. You shall cry and He will say, here I am. I have had the privilege in my life a few times of working with some godly ministers who had a practical religion, and when they prayed, God answered. I've seen it. I've been there. Nobody can tell me God doesn't answer prayers. I've been with people that when they prayed, God answered right away. But there are conditions to answered prayer. Now, prayer is not our subject today, but if you want God to answer your prayers and it seems like your prayers aren't answered, you need to study this chapter. Verse 9, middle of verse 9, if you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger and speaking wickedness, if you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn in the darkness, and your darkness shall be as the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. And then he says to the people that have this kind of an experience, the experience he's been describing, he says, now here is what these people are going to do. And he's talking now about the last days. Notice what he says, starting in verse 12. This is the Lord speaking. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. And you shall be called the repairer of the breach. Are you a repairer of the breach? What's that talking about? Back in Genesis 38, there is recorded a terrible story. I would not suggest that you read this story to your children if they are real young. There are some parts of the Bible that aren't the most appropriate for small children. But I'll read to you a couple of verses from Genesis 38, from this awful story that is recorded. And it says here in Genesis 38, starting with verses 27 to 29, this is Tamar. It says, now it came to pass at the time for giving birth that, behold, twins were in her womb. And so it was when she was giving birth that the one put out his hand, and the midwife took a scarlet thread and bound it on his hand, saying, this one came out first. Then it happened, as he drew back his hand, that his brother came out unexpectedly. And she said, that's the midwife, how did you break through? This breach be upon you. Therefore his name was called Pharez. And the Hebrew word Pharez means a breach. Now this story is, even though it's an awful story, It's in the Bible for a very good reason. God doesn't cover things up. Turn in your Bible to Matthew 1. And in Matthew 1, verse 3, it says, Judah begot Phares and Zerah by Tamar. That's in Matthew 1, 3. It's also mentioned in Luke 3, verse 33. Says, last part of verse 33, it says, the son of Phares, son of Judah. This person whose name was the Breach became a progenitor of Jesus Christ. He was a bastard, an illegitimate child. His name was called a Breach. And that's a very significant word in the Bible. If you look to Daniel, the 11th chapter, this word appears again. In Daniel 11th chapter, usually not translated literally, but this is literally what it means. It's the same word, Phares. Daniel 11th chapter, it says in verse 14, in those times many shall rise up against the king of the south, also certain of those that make a breach of your people. That's for you to study the rest of it out on your own. It says in Daniel 11, verse 14, there's going to be some people in the future that will make a breach among God's people. In prophecy, in Daniel and Revelation, it's spelled out very clearly who it is that will make a breach among God's people. The breach has been made, all right. But it says here in Isaiah 58 that God is going to raise up some people that will be the repairers of the breach. Who is it that is going to be a repairer of the breach? Well, this same chapter tells us who it is that's going to be a repairer of the breach that has been made among God's people. Who is it? Well, notice what it says. It says, you shall be called, this last part of verse 12, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets or paths to dwell in, if you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy day of the Lord honorable, and you shall honor him, not doing your own ways, nor finding your own pleasure, nor speaking your own words, then you shall delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to ride on the high hills of the earth, and feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. Now, in the few minutes that we have left, I don't want to dwell so much on theology as on understanding this passage of Scripture in a practical sense. Most of the chapter, most of Isaiah 58 is about practical things, practical religion, practical Christianity. And it's easy for preachers and theologians and intellectual people to take a passage like this and go through theologically what it's talking about and what it means. That's all right. I'm not condemning that at all. And this chapter is often used as a proof text for the Sabbath because it says there's going to be some people that will repair the breach that has been made in the law of God for many generations, and they're going to repair this breach. And that's true. But notice at the end of the chapter, it says, if you do this, it says, you are going to delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to ride on the high hills of the earth and feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. It says, if you do this, you're going to delight yourself in the Lord. I want to spend the rest of the time we have left on just that one phrase. If you do this, you will delight yourself
in the Lord.
What's that talking about? When the world was first created, God prepared in the center of the earth a garden. Now, those of us that like to study history and theology, I've tried to figure it out. Many theologians and students of the Bible try to figure out where was the Garden of Eden. And so I'm not going to tell you the different possible sites where people have said they think the Garden of Eden was. You can try to figure that out for yourself. It's very interesting to study. And not everybody believes the same thing, by the way. Everybody that I've studied from believe that it's in the Middle East, but where in the Middle East it is, there's a difference of opinion. But that's not the most important thing. In the center of the earth, when God first created the earth, He created in the center of the earth a garden that was called the Garden of Eden. And that's where Adam and Eve lived before they sinned. After they sinned, you can read Genesis 3, they were cast out of that garden. You know why that garden was called the Garden of Eden? Because in the Hebrew language, that word that's translated Eden, that means delight. That was the garden of delight. That's what that means. It was a place where they had perfect happiness and bliss. There was no sorrow, sadness, or pain. There was no loneliness. There was no trouble. There was no disappointment. It was a place of bliss. By the way, I want to be sure you understand this. Do you all understand what bliss is? Bliss is not an easy word to define. So I'm going to try to give it a practical definition that I heard from a preacher a long time ago. May not be according to the dictionary. But bliss is when you are so happy that if you're any more happy, you couldn't stand it. That's what I was told one time. That's what bliss is. You're just so happy that you couldn't stand it if you were any more happy. That's what the Garden of Eden was. It was a garden of delight. Every moment of every day, there was something wonderful happening there. And it was a gorgeous, beautiful place. I was just reading last night in my recreational reading, Ellen White said that the Garden of Eden was like a miniature heaven. It was like a miniature heaven. It was the garden of delight. I want to tell you something, friends, that a lot of people in this world have never comprehended. Jesus Christ is the source not only of life, but He is the source of happiness. And you can never have total and complete happiness in your life until you have Jesus in your life. The Lord says, if you do this, you're going to delight yourself in the Lord. What is He talking about? Well, when the world was first created, and God, you can read it in Genesis 2, Genesis 1 and 2 and 3, and God put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and He gave them the responsibility that they were to take care of the garden. And it was a delight to take care of that garden. There weren't any weeds, by the way, then. There were no diseases. There were no plant diseases. There were no pests. There was no soil that wasn't fertile. The soil was very fertile. And God put them there, but even in Eden, where every day, all day long, everything was exciting and pleasurable and a place of bliss, a place of delight. Even there, God said, there is something more that you need than this to be complete. God said, I'm going to give you a special gift that only He could give. He said, one day in the week, I am going to spend it with you. Now remember who's talking. The one that's talking is the one that's not only the source of life, but the source of all true joy and happiness. He said, I'm going to give you a special gift. One day a week, I am going to spend with you. Unfortunately, friends, in this sinful world, Cain started doing it. Cain said, I'll spend time with you whenever I choose. How would you feel? Let's put it in human terms. How would you feel? I must be careful not to get to telling stories because we don't have time to tell a bunch of stories. But how would you feel if you were a young man and you were courting a girl and you made an appointment to see her at a good time? She said, well, no, I'm not going to meet you then. You'll have to meet me whenever I choose. What? My dear friend, if that was me, that would be the end of the courtship right then. But that's the way people treat the God of heaven. He said, this day is a special day that I have blessed and made a holy day, and I'm going to spend this time with you. And if you'll do it, you're going to find out that you're going to have delight. It says in Isaiah 58. The people in this world, they want to say to the Lord, no, I'll choose to be with you whenever I choose. Friend, that is an insult to the deity. The Bible says that God will not be insulted. He will not be mocked. A dear friend, don't try to play games with God. God will let you go your own way if you want to. But don't try to play games with God. And remember that Jesus Christ is the source of true joy and happiness. And you will never have complete fulfillment in your life, in this life or the future life, unless you are obedient to Him. Jesus said to the Jews in His day, He said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and you don't do what I say? Good question, isn't it? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and you don't do what I say? That's Luke 6:46. Remember, friend, in this sinful world, God has never given up His sovereignty. He's never given it up. He has a right to say, this is when I want to meet with you. And if you will listen to me, you're going to find delight. Let's pray before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, we thank you for your goodness and kindness and mercy toward us, and that when we were ruined, that you devised a way that we could be delivered from the guilt and power of sin, and that we could be brought back to that place where there is bliss and delight forever. Oh Lord, help us to see clearly what is involved in the great controversy, and that we must acknowledge your sovereignty and be obedient to you if we want to experience the delight that you want to give to us. We pray this in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.